Hello everyone, I am Rahul. So today we are going to deal with the fourth part of the our continued series on the economic survey. That is in services sector, we will deal with some of the services and some of the services we dealt in the last video. So I will like to tell you few more services before. Now first one is the direct selling. What is direct selling? Direct selling is the marketing and selling of products directly to consumers away from a fixed retail location or a shop where you buy. So it can be a one-to-one demonstration, it can be a personal contact arrangement, or as well as internet sales, etc. Like the salesman comes to your home. The other kind of marketing can be a multi-level marketing. Now it is a marketing strategy in which the sales force is compensated not only for the sales they generate but also for the sales of the other sales people that they recruit. So this recruited sales force is the participant downline and can provide multiple levels of compensation, that is compensation due to your effort and compensation due to the people you recruit or the business that those people bring will lead to compensation to you. So this is multiple levels of compensation is being provided to you. So there is at present no separate legislation for regulation of direct selling activities. Hence they come under the purview of price cheats, and money circulation schemes banning act 1978. Now, as it is a banning act, there is no provision for differentiating the genuine direct selling business from the banned pyramid money circulation schemes, and this has resulted in alleged harassment and criminal action against the industry. For example, a person makes two members, then these two members make two more members. Till this chain continues, you will be compensated. But as soon as this chain breaks or the pyramid's lower ends are being shortchanged, this whole pyramid crumbles because the money supply stops. Fine. So let's start ahead with the next services, that is media and entertainment services. Now, Indian media and entertainment industry consists of various segments like television, print, films, radio, music, gaming, visual, digital advertising, etc. So the industry has recorded unprecedented growth over the last two decades. As we know, we have thousands of channels. So it is one of the fastest growing industries in India. Now, India is the world's second largest TV market after China, with 168 million TV households, implying a TV penetration of 61%. That is, out of the 100 houses, 61 has TV. Now, the government has taken the initiative to digitize its cable network in four phases, and the final complete digitization is to be done by beginning of 2017. Now, digital, what is the advantage of digital? Digitization leads to improvement in the quality experience felt by the user. Now there are 847 satellite television channels, 243 FM channels, and 190 approximately community radio stations operating in India. So India's broadcasting distribution network comprises 7 DTH operators and thousands of multi-level, multi-system operators. For example, the cable operators that act locally are multi-system operators. Now, Government of India has done the digitization in various phases. First of all, the bigger cities were taken like Delhi, Mumbai, etc. And then later to the smaller towns were covered. And to tell you a secret, many politicians, local level politicians, started their desktop box businesses to cash on the opportunity. So now what advantages digital network gives is it helps in increasing the transparency in the subscriber base and hence leads to increase in tax collection by the government. So this tax collection has been improved both at the center and state level, as has been seen in these 2-3 years. Fine. Now, universal registration by 2017, I have already told you. Now, government is implementing the Broadcasting Infrastructure Network Development Scheme for modernization, upgradation of Prasar Bharati, that is a public broadcaster. As you all know, that the quality, viewership quality is very bad. That the feel that you get out of the not local government channels is not as good as you get on HBO or Stars channels, etc. So India also has been experiencing a higher volume of content consumption due to increasing per capita consumption, media penetration, and use of 3G devices. Now DTH is also growing at a rate of 1 million per year. I also recently have switched on to the DTH because the cable operators, half of the time the cable was not coming and I was getting frustrated. So obviously these will register huge growth. Now there is a technology called HITS technology. HITS is head end in the sky, which will play a key role in achieving the goal of 100% digital distribution in India. So at present we have only 2 HITS operators permitted by Government of India. Also, what is this HITS technology? Now, as compared to traditional cable technology, now at a traditional cable television head end, many multitudes of satellite dishes and antennas are used to grab the cable stations from dozens of communication satellites. But in contrast, HITS combines cable stations into multiplex signals on just a few satellites, and then cable television channels or companies can then pull in hundreds of channels at the local head end with very less equipment required. So it effectively replaces the complex head end operations with many instruments required. Now there exists a large demand for FM channels in many cities, which remain untapped by the private FM radio broadcasting. Obviously, in Delhi you have 10 channels, and in many big cities which are not as big as Delhi, you have only 1-2 channels. But requirement is more because of diversity of content requirement by different kind of people and their choices. Fine. So government of India has taken a decision to allow 839 more private FM radio channels in 294 cities in the third phase of FM. Now India continues to be the world's biggest film producer with more than 1,000 films per year. Now government has also understood to have started this film facilitation office, which is promoting and facilitating film shootings by foreign filmmakers in India. Now National Film Development Corporation has been designated to operate these FFO units at main 4 cities, that is Mumbai, Delhi, Chennai and Kolkata. Now in order to address the issue of skilling in the animation, gaming and visual effects sector, we have National Center for Excellence in Animation, Gaming and Visual Effects to be set up. Now I would like to tell you that there is not much to tell you here. It is just data and also the various informations, but this can come in handy when you want to do essay and all. Still, I would like to explain the terms which are not used commonly. Now coming to the next service called postal services. Now India Postal Network is the largest postal network in the world. It started in the British times when they started it as a penny post, and now it provides affordable access to postal services to all citizens in the country through its vast network. Fine. Now India's 1.55 lakh post offices are there in India. Out of that, 1.39 lakh are in rural areas, so mainly it caters to the rural population, and rest 15,000 are in urban areas. So now post offices are contributing a lot in disbursing wages to MGNREGA beneficiaries. Now 6.92 crore MGNREGA accounts have been opened in post office. Also, towards financial inclusion, the number of post office savings bank account has increased from 31 crore to 34 crore approximately, and total deposits in the banks are approximately 6.53 lakh crores, which are a huge amount if that can be invested for infrastructure and all. Now also more than 80 lakh Sukanya Samridhi Yojana accounts have been opened. Now this scheme was launched very recently, and it provides a high rate of interest of 8.6% per annum, calculated on a yearly basis. That is, it is yearly compounded, and the minimum balance is 1000 rupees and maximum balance can be 150,000 rupees per year. Now it is mainly for the girl child. A legal guardian can open account in the name of girl child. A guardian can also open one account in the name of one girl child and maximum two accounts in the name of two different girl children. Fine. So partial withdrawal, that is maximum up to 50% of the total amount standing, can be done when the girl becomes 18 years of age, and account can be closed after completion of 21 years. Now there also has been PM Suraksha Bima Yojana, PM Jeevan Jyoti Yojana and Atal Pension Yojana, which have been rolled out for the POSB accounts in the core banking solution post office. Now many post offices have been providing the core banking facilities of savings and all. Fine. Also the post offices are undertaking the IT modernization project, where all the processes in the post office are being digitized. It involves computerization and networking of all the post offices, mail offices, accounts offices and administrative offices, etc. Now also 130,000 branch post office in rural areas run by Grameen Dak Sevaks are being modernized or computerized. So far approximately 28,000 departmental post offices have been networked to a wide area network and connected to a data center. So it is the largest single organization's wide area network in the country. Now there are some post offices which also provide core insurance solution too. Not department which has this department which has the mail carrying vehicles with global position system devices also to monitor the mail transmission delivery more effectively. Also a plan scheme called development of road transport network has been approved by the department, and 48 routes have been identified in 16 postal circles that will cover secure transmission of speed post articles, including e-commerce articles, between 107 cities. As you all know, e-commerce is booming and this must be captured by the post office too, as the private courier services are taking its advantage. Now coming to the conclusion of this chapter, this conclusion is a very bigger, not very small conclusion, because it deals with suggestions for each and every services. Now the service sector is like an uncharted sea with plenty of opportunities that have not been fully tapped. So a targeted policy of removing bottlenecks is major, and potential services can result in large dividends in the form of higher services growth and services exports. Now I would like to tell you about the government's focus. Now government's focus should be on infrastructure development, favorable regulatory policies like liberalization of FDI norms, now increasing the number of multi-modal logistic service providers. Multi-modal means through sea also, through air also, through roads, railways also. This is called multi-modal logistic service providing. Also there is growing trend of outsourcing logistics to third party service providers. As you can see in the e-commerce segment, they don't have their own logistical services, but they give it to the couriers like Gati and whatnot, DTDC, etc. Also the entry of global players are expected to provide impetus to this logistics services. Fine. Now coming to the telecom sector, there has been many initiatives like introduction of 4G, inclusion of fiber optic connectivity. It will lead to huge increase in reach and bandwidth, along with greater use of mobiles in government's social sector program. Fine. Now coming to tourism, including medical tourism. Now there is need for improvement in the e-tourist visa and ordinary visa which also includes the extension of E tourist visa window to 180 days instead of currently 30 days before the tour. There is also a need of multiple entry visas. Multiple entry visa is, suppose there is a time period of 6 months you can stay in a country. Out of six months you can come and go many times from the source country to the visiting country. Fine. On the single entry visa, on the single visa. Fine. Now there is demand to increase the stay duration to 60 days under the e-tourist visa instead of 30 days. Also, there is need for making available biometric facility in major ports to help the cruise passengers which are on private trip by ship. There is also need for proper display at e-tourist visa counters, increasing the counters to avoid delays. Also extending e-tourist visa facility for medical tourists. Also streamlining the biometric process in overseas missions by having more biometric locations. Fine. Coming to tax issues. Now this place of provision clause in service tax is resulting in tourism services not being treated as export of service and being taxed. This place of provision means that where the service is consumed. Now the tourism services are consumed in India only. Foreign tourists are coming, but they are providing the foreign currency. So this means that it is actually an export, but it is not considered as export and is not being exempted and is being taxed, which should not be. Also, there is need for lower GST for tourism related services as in many OECD countries, though GST has not come into implementation. Now coming to the finance and investment related issues. Now tax free bonds and income tax exemption on profits used in the investment in the tourism sector. Suppose the tourism agencies or tourism companies take tax-free bonds, then they should be tax-free, and then the income tax exemption should be given if they spend that money that they earned a profit on in the tourism only. Fine. Also, there should be development of tourism on PPP basis, that public and private come with each other to develop the tourism. Also, CSR fund should be towards the tourism sector. Then small and medium enterprises in the tourism sector should be helped by venture capitalist by investing money in the tourism sector. Also, extension of Mudra Yojana to SMEs should be examined. Now, government should also try setting up India Hearts in major cities with miniature cultural India by channelizing CSR spending or under PPP mode. So it will tell about the culture of India to various tourists. Now moving forward to the medical tourism. Now promoting medical tourism in the Brand India campaign instead of the current fragmented approach which has been taken till now. We should also have rapid immigration clearances for medical tourists, enhanced basic infrastructure for medical tourists at airports, streamlining the medical visa process, they should be given in one go, and extending the e-tourist visa to medical tourists, promoting geriatric health care. What is geriatric? Geriatric is for the old age people, that is above 60 years of age. And we should use our expertise in Ayurveda, Yoga and Unani, because these Ayurveda, Yoga and Unani do not have side effects which the allopathic medicines have. Now, getting international accreditation for Indian hospitals, because they will create trust in the mind of the people who are coming for medical tourism that these hospitals are reputed. Also, addressing the exchange risk factor for medical tourists, because if the people come for getting some surgery which is very costly in some other countries, and if the exchange rate fluctuation happens, they might become poor or they might get affected by this fluctuation. Also promoting the telemedicine where the doctors can directly contact with the patients through internet. Now miscellaneous reforms which are required. We need a national cruise strategy. We need to make railways more tourist friendly with cleanliness and hygiene. When I see the railways in the foreign countries, I get very happy because I can see very attractive trains coming to the station and taking the passengers away. But in India, you get a very bad feel when you see the trains. Whatever train it might be, it looks like a very old kind of style of the bogies. Now, e-booking with special quotas for foreign visitors should be there. While I don't agree with it, everybody is equal. Why should you give a special quota to foreign visitors? They should book it earlier. Sorry. Introducing smart cards for e-payments across all tolls in India and national permit for tourist vehicles. When you have smart card, then you will not be blocked in the tolls and you don't have to wait for so long. Also, we should consider global parameters while deciding coastal regulation zone norms so that we come at par in the global norms. Also, we should organize tourism fairs in Indian embassies abroad. Now, coming to the shipping and port services. Now, you know that because of less demand, the prices of steel and all are very low. So, and also cheaper finance is available and longer tenure of funds are also available. And also, our ships are aging. So, this is a huge opportunity for the shipping sector to make a capital out of it by securing the assets like ships and all the instruments and all, because they are very cheaper now, and this will help the shipping sector in long term. Shipping sector should also address the issues like high capital cost of the ships and other instruments. It also needs to aid for importing quality machines in maintenance and dredging. Dredging is digging of the land under the sea. Also, making India bunkering hub by allowing zero duty on bunkers for all segments of coastal shipping. This is very important. It will make a bunkering hub. And also, not just for containers as it is being done at present. Now, we should also explore the possibility of creating an Indian production and indemnity company. Fine. And also, we should try to refinance through ECB funds. Suppose we have taken loans which were at high interest rate, but ECB funds we are getting at very low interest rates. So we can finance the old loans with the new loans taken through ECB route. ECB is external commercial borrowings that we take from foreign financial institutions like World Bank and also the various other foreign governments also, and companies also, you can say, or many financial institutions also, which is not now permitted. Also, we need to improve our port infrastructure on a war footing. On a war footing means as soon as possible, and we need to find a way to rationalize our prices, which are very high for port services in India. Now, coming to the IT services. Now, IT services, we need to resolve visa issues like this. Grassley-Durbin reform bill is being put in the US, which creates problem from Indian IT for Indian IT professional to procure this H-1B visa and even L-1 visas. Also, US has hiked the visa fee, which is not congenial for Indian IT professionals. Fine. Now, we should also focus on high-end software products to be competitive in the market. We should promote our domestic apps. We should have comprehensive approach to startups and entrepreneurship. As you know, the Startup India policy has just now been released. We should have clarity of the proposed GST, given the dual level levies of value added tax and service tax, and the levy should be only one. We should also have clarity on e-commerce taxation issue, and it is very difficult to get payments for the government works which have been allocated, as I can verify this statement as my brother who works for government contracts. Like, he gets contracts from government and gives them the supply, and for getting money he has to roam around from one department to another. Now, also extending the 200% VAT deduction on R&D expenditure to the IT industry on the lines of R&D incentives to the IT sector in the UK and many other countries. We should have deduction. Now, we should also extend the service exports from India scheme to the IT sector in light of proposed phasing out of SEZ. SEZ was giving many benefits to the IT sector, which will now be taken out. So it should be given to the IT firms in the form of services exports from India scheme. Now coming to the Indian Aviation Services. Now India's service sector has improved a lot because of decrease in the price of aviation fuel, which comprises 80% of its operating expenses. I have already told you in the last video. We should also think about the liberalization of FDI policy in civil aviation. And also we are seeing the strong growth in passenger traffic, which is expected to continue in the near future. Coming to the retail, the outlook remains obviously positive as we have huge population to consume. And India continues to remain an attractive long-term retail destination despite various challenges. So various announcements like allocation of 1,000 crores to technology and startup sectors, promotion of cashless transactions via RuPay debit cards, and growth of e-commerce have been mentioned. And these can give a boost to this sector. So thank you everyone. Please like, comment and subscribe to www.decipheris.com. Please like our Facebook page. I am covering the most important points which are required for the UPSC point of view.